Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Lieven van Voren, and I'm from the company Pharmavice in Belgium. And today I will present you some information about early drug product development. So I will talk about appropriate standards and practices in early drug development and manufacturing. So this talk will be focused on clinical trial development, clinical trial material development, and manufacturing. So I will first talk a little bit about what Pharmavice is exactly doing. So we are a service company, and I will give you some details here. Then I will talk about the chemical pharmaceutical development process, so some words about formulation development, also about analytical development. Then subsequently, I will go to the GMP manufacturing. So what are now, let's say, the particularities for GMP manufacturing of clinical trial materials? And then I present a case study with a project plan, and last, some take-home messages. So Pharmavice is a company that was established in 1995, and at that time we were a regulatory consultancy company. So what we do, what we did, and what we still do today is the writing of regulatory dossiers for submission at European and U.S. authorities, as well as new registrations, existing registrations, variations, clinical trial applications. So let's say all the different chem pharm writings regarding regulatory we can perform. So today we operate from Mariakerke. We have a brand new state-of-the-art facility where we have offices, laboratory space, and manufacturing clean rooms. We provide CMC services to the pharmaceutical industry. That means we are a contract research organization, and we do not do our own product development. So we work 100% for the pharmaceutical customers. Today we are with 32 people, and here you can see how we expanded our activities throughout the years. So we started with the regulatory and quality services. Quality services is, for example, auditing, implementation of GMP systems at our customers. And then around the year 2000, we started in the contract research activities, formulation development, analytical development. In the beginning, we did not have our own laboratories. We worked in close collaboration with university. And then in 2006, we made a big decision for the company. We invested in a brand new facility that you can see there, where we have all these services under one roof. In 2006, we moved to the facility, and there, also in the same year, we obtained our GMP license for the manufacturing of non-sterile clinical trial materials. So here you see the business model of Pharmavice. In fact, we have three different business units, and these three units allow us to give our customers, let's say, an overall complete CMC service. This is very important for clinical trial work because if you need many different partners for your development, that makes things going on very slow. So therefore, we try to provide a complete one-stop shop for our customers. So you can see the three divisions. So the first division is what we call the consultancy division. There you have the regulatory support, the quality support, auditing. So I will not talk in my presentation about this unit, but I will talk in my presentation about these two units. So the contract research unit, formulation development, analytical development, and stability studies. And last, the contract manufacturing, so where we have in our clean rooms the possibility to do GMP small-scale manufacturing. So small-scale, nearly intended for phase I, phase II studies, where only limited amount of materials have to be manufactured. Besides the manufacturing, we can also do labeling activities, clinical supply labeling, and all other types of activities needed to support clinical trials, like import of materials, release of materials, QP release of materials can also be done at Pharmavice. So here you see our customer base. So about 50%, we have about 50 customers for the moment coming to us with their projects, and about half of our projects are related to big pharma, and then a quarter for the small, medium enterprises, and another quarter for the startup companies. Now, when you do development for clinical trials, there are certain challenges. I want to give you an overview of certain challenges that we have to cope with. First of all, I'm talking specifically over small molecules, so we are focusing on small molecules, not biotech products. Well, there are some API properties. So the molecules that are developed over the last years, they become more and more difficult to formulate. And why is it? Well, many APIs have now decreased solubility. So in the so-called BCS classification, they are in the class 2 and 4, which means low solubility and a low or high permeability. So these low solubility compounds, they need a specific formulation approaches, and that's where PharmaVice is strong in. These compounds nowadays, the new APIs also have increasing lipophilicity, increasing molecular weight, so they become larger and larger in structures and decreasing permeability. But that's not everything. Also, other challenges exist, the regulatory requirements. So as I told you, we are starting from regulatory business, so we have a very good view on the regulatory framework, and we see that the regulatory requirements are becoming more and more stringent. So like, for example, to give you one example, genotoxin impurities. This is something 10 years ago when you did a submission of a clinical trial, IMPD, you did not have to talk about this topic. But now, today, you cannot avoid it anymore. So even in a first submission for a phase 1 study, this is a topic that you will have to explore. So in this perspective, there are many more stringent requirements also for the early clinical work. And another reason, quite important, is competition. So there are many different pharmaceutical companies working on the same targets, and once a decision has been made to go forward with the development, then everything should go fast. And so we are in a competitive pharmaceutical world, and many projects go into an accelerated development, so that means that the customer wants to have its clinical trial as soon as possible. In a typical project that we execute for our customers, the customers come to PharmaVice with their API, which has already been developed and manufactured by an API manufacturer, and then PharmaVice will start working on the formulation work in order to develop an appropriate drug product. Now, one of the first questions we always discuss with our customers when we start a new project, a development project, is, will we go with a liquid or a solid formulation? So there are, for both, there are some pros and cons for these. Like, a liquid formulation is a very flexible formulation because you can play on the concentration and on the volume, so you have a very wide dosing window that you can apply with liquid formulation. Typically, the development time for a liquid is faster. So if we have a customer that comes with an API and says, look, I want to do a phase 1 study in 4 months from here, well, then I would recommend, well, I would recommend the liquid development project because this is going to happen faster. And one of the reasons that this trajectory is faster is that you don't need to bother too much about the solid state properties. So if the particle size, the polymorphism, the salt selection, if these activities are not yet finished, you are still possible to go with your liquid formulation, while for a solid formulation, you will have to consider these properties even for a first phase 1 study. So these are all, let's say, benefits of a liquid. There is also a negative point to this, being that when you go in further development, phase 2, phase 3, most of the customers, they want to have a solid. On the market, solids are much more popular than liquids, and therefore, when a switch is to be made from a liquid to a solid formulation, for example, in phase 2 or phase 3, then you might need some additional clinical bioequivalent studies in order to make the bridge between the liquid and the solid. And that is exactly the reason that some of our customers, they immediately want to go into the phase 1 studies with a solid. So that allows them a seamless transition to the later phases. But on the other hand, it will need more development work on the API and also more development work on the drug product. So here you see, for the early clinical studies, what are now the most, let's say, popular formulations. So this one is the aqueous solutions, aqueous suspensions. This is non-aqueous solutions, like, for example, the API solubilized in an organic medium, polyethylene glycol, propylene glycol, or so. These are powder-filled capsules. So you see, this is quite a significant part. Early phase studies going immediately with a powder-filled capsule, about 25%. This one, it's not clear in the legend, but these are liquid-filled capsules. I will discuss that a little bit further in my talk, these liquid-filled capsules. And this is then a minority. This is reconstitution formulations. When the stability is a problem, then it is an idea to keep the powder and the liquid separate and just combine them at the moment of dosing. So also in this segment, we have now and then projects. So I come now to these liquid-filled capsules. So this is a particular technology that we often apply, as you could see, about 25% of our manufacturings, for lipid for APIs with a low bioavailability. And so one of these, let's say, new class APIs. And what we could do with these low APIs with low solubility in aqueous media, well, we try to dissolve them in a lipid medium, so an oily phase. And often these APIs can be dissolved in oil instead of water. And then we put the oil into a capsule. So this is applicable for a wide range of chemical entities. And there are many, let's say, formulation tricks, formulation possibilities that you have. We can work with surfactants, co-surfactants, co-solvents. So you have many, many possibilities in order to have a good formulation. The name of the technology is called LiCaps. So the LiCaps technology stands for liquid-filled capsules. It's a technology developed by Capsugel. And we have in our facility the machine that allows to fill these oils in capsules. The same technology also exists for, let's say, the commercial scale manufacturing, this LiCaps technology. So that means that if a customer would be fine with such a formulation, it is also possible to use such liquid-filled capsules for commercial formulations. Now, when it regards solids with a low bioavailability, we also need to apply specific approaches like micronization, nanonization. So the principle of these technologies is that we reduce the particle size, so of the API, and that increases the bioavailability. So the exposure is higher, the specific surface is higher, and we have then a better bioavailability. So we do that by means of physical forces. So in our plant, we do nanonization using ball milling technology. So zirconium beads together with the API suspension is milled, and then after, let's say, 10, 20, 30 hours milling, you have a serious reduction of the API into the nanometer scale. Other possibilities we use to increase bioavailability is the spray drying. This principle of spray drying is that we turn the crystallographic form into an amorphous form. So the crystallographic structure of a crystalline material is typically something that goes difficult in solution, but when it is amorphous, it's much more easy to bring it in solution. So this is the principle. And in fact, the same principle is also used by melt extrusion. There we will dissolve the particles in a polymer using heat. So the same principle, when the API is in the polymer, it is in amorphous phase, and it will have a better dissolution. Other techniques can also be applied, like granulation, extrusion, spheronization, drying, coating. So we have, let's say, all these basic technologies in-house for small-scale manufacturing. So now I go a little bit further in the, let's say, formulation development process. So it's applicable, this concept, for liquids and solids, but in my further slides I will focus on some liquid examples. So these properties that I sum here are very important for determination. So we always have to determine solubility, dissolution, resistance against precipitation. So this is something that we have developed in-house, and I will come back to this in the next slide, so the IV2-Sol. Also, intrinsic stability is very important in early phase. So even the first pre-formulations that we manufacture, we will put them on a stability program, a short-term stability program, for example, 1 month, 40 degrees, and that allows us to have already some idea about the stability in a vehicle. Sometimes we also use in vivo properties. Typically, we first do the in vitro properties, and if required, if we are not 100% certain of which formulation we will choose, then we can also set up rat and mouse experiments to have an idea about the bioavailability. And just here a graph, sorry. Just here in this graph, it's an API solubilized in different vehicles. So it's a solution, TPGS, Invitor, Capriol, Capmigliol. And you can see that just by changing the vehicle, that the bioavailability can change dramatically. And just the choice of the vehicle can have such a big impact on the bioavailability. So this is a very, let's say, useful measurement then to make a selection for your API. So now I will go a little bit more in detail about this IV2-Sol, because this is a very useful platform. And what we do, in fact, it's a kind of reverse dissolution test. So the principle is the following. We will first make a number of candidate solutions, the API, in different vehicles. And for example, Labrazole, TPGS, polyethylene glycol, propylene glycol, so a whole battery of vehicles. And then we will So first of all, we have to find the vehicles with sufficient solubility. This is the first step. And when we have selected, let's say, 5 to 10 of these vehicles, we will then put them in an aqueous environment. So we will dilute them in simulated fluids, simulated intestinal fluids, simulated gastric fluids, simulated plasma fluid for injectable formulations. And then we will see what happens. Because what could happen in reality when you have a nice liquid with the API solubilized, it could happen when it comes into your gastrointestinal system that the API precipitates. And then it's not bioavailable, it's not available anymore, so we need to avoid that. So with this platform, we try more or less to simulate what will happen into the body when the API in its vehicle will enter in an unfavorable aqueous environment. And we want to select these vehicles, these solvents, where the API stays in solution. And you will see some graphs in the next slide about this. So we incubate, after we have diluted the formulation, for example, 1 to 10 in the medium, we incubate typically 37 degrees, we keep shaking, and we use these type of well plates for the measurements. Then these well plates are placed in an optical reader, and we follow the optical density, or we could also perform HPLC if required. So you can see here some examples of wells which remain clear. So these are, let's say, the beneficial vehicles, and some wells give precipitation. This is then an unwanted vehicle. So I give you some example curves on the next slide. So what you see here is a time profile over 2 hours. We typically measure over 2 hours. And here you see the optical density measured in these small wells with the optical reader. So there are some formulations like the red one here. It's the API in a hydroxypropyl beta cyclodextrin solution. And you can see after dilution in the aqueous medium, there is no optical density. So that means the API stays in solution. So that's, let's say, a positive point. There are other vehicles which show precipitation, and I would say for further development we don't use these ones that have shown this precipitation, but we further develop with these ones. Now a few words. So besides the formulation activities, there are also particularities for the analytical development. Well, we use as much as possible compendial methods from the pharmacopoeia, but we have also to develop our own methods, like for the impurities and dissolution measurements. The main development efforts we do is on impurity determination. So this is the development of HPLC, UPLC methods. And nowadays we use more and more UPLC rather than HPLC because it goes much faster. So in the HPLC method development, we apply an appropriate validation versus development stage. So for a phase one study, you will use a lesser extensive validation activity than for a phase three. So we keep there, let's say, an appropriate level. We will develop stability indicating methods that will allow us, when the API starts to degrade, that we can also see and pick up the degradation products. And most of our methods, they are based upon the API method that has been developed prior to our activity. For dissolution method development, we also have a very, let's say, good experience with dissolution method development. There, it is important to have methods with discriminative power. And then a slide about the manufacturing. Well, GMP manufacturing for early clinical trials needs a high degree of flexibility because processes are not yet fully developed. API batches that are used for the development are not always representative. And also clinical study designs can change through the development process. Like, for example, the sponsor can just ask while you are developing to have another dose in the study and so on. So that means that for the early clinical manufacturing, you need a dedicated approach, a non-routine approach, and that's exactly the niche where PharmaVise is working on, small-scale manufacturing dedicated on these, let's say, difficult, unvalidated projects where there are many issues that can take place. We also use staged automation. So for very small batches, like a phase one study, we often use manual filling of capsules. And for the larger scale, we have then automatic filling. So in our facility, we work with oral solutions, suspensions, topical ointments, creams, powder-filled capsules, liquid-filled capsules, tablets, and powders for reconstitution. So this is a timeline slide to show you a case study of a project. So how do we handle the development project? You can see that it normally takes about 10 months time to do a full development, starting with some solubility excipient compatibility testing, also IV to salt testing, followed by some stability screening, followed by optimization if needed and analytical development, upscaling activity to, let's say, a more GMP representative scale, performing stability studies on these upscaled materials, and then also write the IMPD for the regulatory submission, and finally the GMP manufacturing of the material, including labeling and so on. So the whole process, you have to take into account 10 months. It can be longer if there are stability issues. It can be shorter if there are no issues at all to be resolved. And to finalize my presentation, I have some take-home messages for you. So first of all, in a clinical development trajectory, the complexity of such a CMC development process is determined, as I said in my speech here, about the physicochemical characteristics of the API, the regulatory framework, and not unimportant, the number of parties involved. So this is our vision, that you best keep the number of parties in such a development process as limited as possible. Now, for the early clinical trials, we would recommend to avoid complexity. So let's say complexity can be entered in later development, but for a simple phase one study, we try to keep it as simple as possible. We will not use, for example, preservatives if it is not really necessary. Just keep simple formulations to have, let's say, the best chance for success in a short time period. And then the early phase GMP manufacturing is a non-routine business, so you better do it, let's say, with a dedicated contractor specialized in these small-scale clinical manufacturing, rather than going to, let's say, a larger-scale routine manufacturer of commercial medications. And last, the speed of development is very important. Once a sponsor has made a decision to go forward, everything should go fast. So you must have, let's say, a good machinery to run such a development project. And if you want to have more information, we are here on this floor with our booth, so you have still the whole day to come and visit us. Thank you for your attention.